I don't know how to sing softly. Well, I do, but I don't like to sing softly. When I sing something like this thrills my soul, and I have a hard time being very quiet about it. The kingdom of peace. There's a theme that is sweet to my memory. There's a joy that I cannot express. There's a treasure that gladdens my being. 'Tis the kingdom of God's righteousness. 'Tis a kingdom of peace. It is reigning within. It shall ever increase in my soul. We possess it right here when we taste from all sin. And 'twill last while the ages shall roll. There's a scene of its grandness before me. Of its greatness there can be no end. It is joy, it is peace, it is glory. In my heart how these riches do blend. 'Tis the kingdom of peace, it is reigning within. It shall ever increase in my soul. We possess it right here when he saves from all sin. And 'twill last while the ages shall roll. I am lost in its splendor and beauty. To its ne'er-fading heights I would rise. Till I see the King come to receive me. And explore it with him in the skies. 'Tis the kingdom of peace, it is reigning within. It shall ever increase in my soul. We possess it right here when he saves from all sin. And 'twill last while the ages shall roll. What a pleasure in life it is bringing. Amen. What assurance and hope ever bright. Oh, what rapture and bliss are awaiting when our faith shall be lost in the sight. 'Tis the kingdom of peace, it is reigning within. It shall ever increase in my soul. We possess it right here when he saves from all sin. And 'twill last while the ages shall roll. Amen. I am lost in its splendor and beauty. People might think my mind wanders from time to time. Amen, it does. It's lost in the splendor and the beauty of God's kingdom of peace and his righteousness and his holiness and his joy. When you wonder where Brother Frazier is, that's probably where he's at. He's lost, wandering around in God's kingdom. To its ne'er-fading heights. That word ne'er there, they just took out the V. To its never-fading heights. His kingdom will never fade. This kingdom of joy, peace, and righteousness, I don't care what happens in this world, it will never fade. That's why it's so precious. That's why it thrills my soul. That's why I get up here and I get excited and I get loud sometimes and I offend people sometimes because this thing excites my soul. Amen. To its ne'er-fading heights I would rise. I wish I could be there right now. Amen. I'm glad I'm here with you folks, and I'm glad you're here, and I love you to death, and I love you, girls, my wife, I love you. But I'll tell you what, if God called me home, there'd be some shouting and rejoicing tonight. Amen. Don't you cry over me. You can cry a little bit because I'm not here, but I want you to be rejoicing. I want my daughters to be rejoicing. Their dad is having the best time of his life. We've seen him had a good time here on earth, but I know he's having a good time now. Amen. To its near-fading heights I would rise, till I see the King come to receive me and explore it with him in the skies. Are you
ready to explore? Are you ready to explore the people that are in heaven? Are you ready to sit down and talk with Abraham? Are you ready to sit down and talk with some of the disciples? Are you ready to sit down and talk with Philip? Say, Philip, I was just like you. I had my troubles. I doubted. Man, wasn't that terrible when we doubt? How'd you make it through it, Philip? Oh, Jesus, give me grace. Jesus was patient with me. Amen. I want to see some of the people that fail, because I fail from time to time. I was a person that shouldn't have been from time to time. So I want to talk to some of those people, and then I want to talk to some of the heroes too. But I'm looking forward to that day when I can explore it with him in the skies, because it truly is a wonderful kingdom. There was one more song, since we're singing songs tonight, and I seen one in here. It may be in your hymnal too. Just give me a second to get back there. Page 149 in the Evening Light hymnal. Glorious Peace, do you have that? Does anyone know that one? Page 12 in your little pink booklet. Sister Kate, can you play that one for me? All right. And then I'll stop. Well, actually, I'm going to sing one more after that, because I printed this one off before I left home. Excuse me. And I don't know how deep the snow's getting out there, but I'll tell you what, my soul's getting flooded, so that's okay. Let it snow. If you need a ride home, I got a four-wheel drive. We'll all pile in there, and we'll get you home. I came defiled and guilty to Jesus the mighty to save. He took my sins and sorrows and beauty for ashes gave. Peace, peace, glorious peace, like tranquil water. White as the driven snow, I came to Jesus repenting, confessing my every sin. My heart's door swung wide open, and glorious peace flowed in. Amen. Peace, peace, glory. White as the driven snow. And since that joyful moment of glorious peace to me, my soul has ceased its pining, my life has been light and free. Peace, peace, glory. White as the driven snow. Roll on, ye changing seasons of turbulent seas of sin. I found the blessed shelter and glorious peace within. Peace, peace, glory. Tranquil waters flow, streaming down over my heart, made white as the driven snow. Amen. Glorious peace. I have found a blessed treasure, or I have found a blessed shelter and glorious peace within. Just a beautiful song. The words there are so powerful, so moving. I came defiled and guilty to Jesus, the mighty to save. And he took my sins and my sorrows. Amen. He took them all on himself. Every one of them. And when he took them, he didn't just leave me empty, but he gave me back beauty. He gave me back holiness. He gave me back righteousness. He gave me back peace. Peace. Glorious peace. Not like the world gives you, but a glorious peace. Amen. One more song and then I'll quit. And I don't even know if I can sing this now, but I'll try. I had the tune in my head, but now that we've sang so many songs, I don't know if I can get it back in my head. Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within. I started out too low. Yes, but it was too low. Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within. Could be, but they. I only had two verses. They're in the red choir book. I don't know that I need to learn it. But yep, I had those verses. I just couldn't figure out the tune because I'm not used to singing with Sister Kate playing it. That's what I was going to try to do. I was having trouble finding the right pitch, though. Oh, what a Savior. Oh. What a Savior. There it is, page 12. No, no. This has two sharps.
Okay. Well, that's higher. I better keep it down.
Yeah, you better keep it where you had it.
Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. They searched through heaven and found a Savior to save a poor lost soul like me. Oh, what a Savior! Oh, hallelujah! His heart was broken on Calvary. His hands were nailed, scarred. His side was riven. He gave his life blood for even me. He left the Father with all his riches, with calmness sweet and serene, came down from heaven and gave his life blood to make the vilest sinner clean. Oh, what a Savior! Oh, hallelujah! He gave his life's blood on Calvary. Hands were nailed, scarred. His side was riven. He gave his life's blood for me.
Excuse me.
Death's chilly waters I'll soon be crossing. His hand will lead me safe for. I'll join the chorus in that great city.
Amen. And sing up there. Amen. Forever and evermore.
Oh, what a Savior. Oh, hallelujah. He gave his life's blood for you and me. His hands were nailed, scarred. His side was riven. He gave his life's blood for you and me.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Kate. We really got to work on that.
We did great,
yes. And it was for the glory of the Lord. Amen. What a Savior.
It pleased the Lord anyway.
Amen. Just a few scriptures tonight. I won't keep you very long, I promise. It's already 7 o'clock. I thought we'd be out of here by now, but we're not. Here we are. Turn with me to John. John in chapter 21. Very familiar passage of Scripture. Everyone knows this. We've even covered it some in Sunday school or Bible study on Sunday mornings with Sister Kathy. But I want to read it again and want to emphasize a couple of points. I guess starting John 21, chapter 21, verse 15. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And he saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus said unto him, Feed my sheep. Verily, verily, I say unto you, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walketh whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thine hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he saith unto him, Follow me. Then Peter, turning about, seeth the disciple whom Jesus loved following, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? And Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do? And Jesus saith unto him, If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. Who are we following tonight? Follow thou me is what Jesus said. Jesus said, don't you worry about the other people. Don't you get sidetracked in what somebody else is doing and what I've got for them. You follow me. You stick with me. You know, there's a lot of following going on today in our world. A lot of following. People follow TV programs. I've got some kinfolks back in Virginia that they get all worked up about this TV program. What is it, The Voice or something like that? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yep, Caleb knows. Caleb gets all excited too. Uh-oh, The Voice is coming on. It's 8 o'clock. Let me get over here. I'll tell you what, they'll get more fired up and more excited about that thing than they will about going to church. That's sad. What are they doing? They're following something. What is Twitter? Anybody here know what Twitter is? I bet you these do. I bet you these over here do. What do you do on Twitter? You tweet, but what is it called? You follow somebody, right? Yes. They don't want to admit it. But you follow people. And people will get on there and they'll tweet, you know, they'll write a little message. They call it tweeting or whatever. But they'll type a little message and they'll send it out. And then all their followers will be able to see that little message. Same thing basically with Facebook. You got people that follow other people on Facebook. You'll be able to see whatever they post. It'll pop up on your screen on what's called your world. Your wall, and you'll be able to see. What are you doing? You're basically following that person. You're following their day-to-day actions. You're following what's going on in their life. Your attention is focused on them. Jesus said, Follow thou me. That's what Jesus said. And he said that to Peter, and it echoes down through the ages to us in the day and time that we live. Some people today follow the news. They follow trends. They follow styles. And there's much more insidious things that go along that are followed in our culture, in the lives that we live today. I got to thinking about following and following Jesus and following God's Word. One reason that I think that my mind was turned towards these things is because there's so many distractions in the world today. I've seen so many times that even in churches, people get to following other people. And I bring this up, following Jesus and following His Word and following His truth. Because in the coming weeks, we're going to be preaching some more from Revelations. Most of you all are very familiar with the Church of God Revelation message, right? Amen. Don't follow me. You follow the Lord Jesus. You follow me as I follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm here to tell you, since it's a small crowd, that the message of Revelations is not going to sit well with everybody that hears it. It's not going to sit well with everybody that hears it. Be sure that you're following the voice of the Lord. Be sure that you're following Jesus Christ and His Word and the truth. Don't get to following some other man or some other woman or some other thing. Because that happens all the time in churches. You get little cliques. And you got one person that gets a little disgruntled. And they start murmuring and complaining. They start planting a seed here. And they start planting a seed here. You better be careful who you're following. What happened in the wilderness? The children of God, what did they do? The Israelites, they got to murmuring. Do you think they all started murmuring and complaining at one time? Do you think they all just rose up and started murmuring and complaining all together? Nope. I'll guarantee you it was one or two or three. And then they started to work. And they started to go around. And you know that Moses. He done let us out here. We ain't got nothing to eat. We ain't got nothing to drink. Our shoes are wearing out. Our clothes are wearing out. Why should we keep following this man? Amen. That's the way dissension starts. That's the way division starts. It starts with one or two complaining and murmuring and fussing. Be sure that you're following God. Be sure that you're following the truth. The only time that I ask that you would follow me is follow me as I follow Christ. As you see the example of Christ lived out in my life, and you can confirm it by the scriptures. When you see love coming out of me, when you see me visiting, when you see me praying for the sick, when you see me doing the things that are described in the Bible, you follow me. Amen? But other than that, you be careful. Because I'm a man. I can make mistakes. I'm fallible. I'm no, you know, God standing in the pulpit. I could get off track. So I'm telling you tonight, make sure that you're following Jesus Christ. I thought of following God's will and God's word, and I thought of Joseph. And I know that's a weird place to go, but anyway, I did. And if you would, turn over with me to Genesis chapter 39. This was pretty early in Joseph's life in Egypt. And he was in Potiphar's house. And we want to pick it up in verse 7. Joseph had now been in Potiphar's house. Potiphar had put him in charge of many things. But he came to a place where he was faced with temptation. He was faced with choices that were very hard. Genesis chapter 39, verse 7. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said unto his master's wife, "Behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I, neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And it came to pass, as she spoke to Joseph day by day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business. And there was none of the men of the house there within. And she caught him by the garment, saying, "Lie with me." And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. And it came to pass, when she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and was fled forth, that she called unto the men of the house and spake unto them, saying, "See, he hath brought in a Hebrew unto us to mock us. He came in unto me to lie with me, and I cried with a loud voice." We're going to stop right there. But I just want you to think about Joseph's situation for a minute. And who was Joseph following? Joseph had amazing power, amazing position in Potiphar's house. Everything that Potiphar had was at his disposal, except for one thing, his wife. Now, they were living in a heathen culture. Joseph had probably been pretty much raised in a heathen culture after he was sold. He was sold as a young boy. I think what the Bible says, he was 12 years old, something thereabouts, 10 or 12. So you know that he had been influenced by this culture. He had been influenced by their teachings. He had been influenced by all that was presented to him in Egypt. But yet, who did he follow? Who did he hold himself accountable to? Who do we hold ourselves accountable to? It doesn't matter what my wife does. It doesn't matter what my wife thinks. What matters is what God thinks. Am I going to follow what she wants, or am I going to follow what God wants? Am I going to follow what somebody in this congregation wants, or am I going to follow what God wants? That's what's important, folks. He said to her, How can I do this great wickedness and sin against Potiphar? Sin against the Pharaoh of Egypt? Sin against you, his wife? Nope. Joseph said, how can I commit this great wickedness and sin against God? That's who we're accountable to, folks. That's who we are to be following, is the example of God. Do you want to end up like Jonah? Jonah didn't want to follow God. Jonah didn't want to follow God's example. He didn't want to see a single Ninevite saved. He wanted to see them all burned. Amen? But God had other plans. The other person that I thought about was Simon the sorcerer. Turn to Acts chapter 8. And we're going to read a pretty big portion of Scripture here, but I do it just so you can get all the context of the Scripture. Acts chapter 8, and start in verse 5. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsy, and that were lame, were healed. And there was great joy in that city. But there was a certain man named Simon, or called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. Did you notice there? And we're going to read on a little bit further, but I just want to stop for a second. Two times the word heed has been used already in this passage of Scripture. In verse 6, it says, the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake. They gave heed unto them. They gave an ear. And then they heard, and then they conformed their life. They started to follow. If you give heed to something, that means you're starting to follow it. Same thing happened down in verse 10. This guy, Simon, had bewitched the people using sorcery and magic and all these things, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest. What happened? They started giving heed to Simon. They started looking to Simon. They started following Simon. Let's read on a little bit further. And to him they had regard, because that of long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. And when they believed Philip's preaching, the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, behold the miracles and signs which were done. Now when the apostles, which were at Jerusalem, heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, and he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that whomsoever I lay hands on, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. Who was Simon following? He sure wasn't following the Lord Jesus Christ. He sure wasn't experiencing the message of Jesus Christ in its fullness. I'm sure that he did not have the Holy Ghost filling within him. Why? Because he was following men. It said he looked on Peter and John, and when he saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, what was he mesmerized by? Was he mesmerized by the message of grace? By the message of Jesus Christ? Was he mesmerized by the message of holiness and righteousness and your sins forgiven and washed away? No, he was mesmerized by the power of some man. He wanted to follow, and he wanted to be like those men instead of being like the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we're not careful, we'll find one person that we like the way he talks, or we like the way he speaks, or we like what he brings, and we'll get hooked on him, and we'll be following him. Amen. Amen. I've seen it happen a lot of times. It repeats itself. Be sure that you're not following me. Be sure that you are rooted and grounded in the truth of God's word. Because I could drop dead tonight before I get home. Then who are you going to follow? You're going to wait for the next man to come along and follow him? Be sure you're following the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that you all are faithful in that. But it helps to remind. It helps to keep people focused. And the last thing I want is to be set up on a pedestal and worshiped. Amen. I don't want that. I don't want it to be Brother Frazier said this and Brother Frazier said this. I want it to be thus saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord. Because Brother Frazier could be wrong. He can make a mistake. He is a fallible human being. Paul said to the Corinthians in chapter 11, verse 1, follow me. Or actually, let's flip over here and read it. Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Why did he say that? Go back up the verse before. Even as I please all men in all things, not seeking mine own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. What was Paul's goal? What was Paul's objective in pleasing men, in reaching out to men, in trying to bring the gospel in a way that could be understood to whoever it was he was talking to? What was his objective? That men could be saved. And then he said, since I'm working to see men saved, you be followers of me as I am of Christ. Because why was Christ here? To seek and to save that which was lost. Paul was following the example of Jesus Christ. Let's make sure that we're doing that same thing. Turn over with me to 2 Peter, and we're going to get out of here in just a minute. Second Peter. Chapter 1. Verse 10. Wherefore the rather, brethren. Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and your election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. I read that verse because it's your responsibility to make your call and your election sure. It's not my responsibility to see you into heaven. But it's your responsibility that you make your call and your election sure. If you have not received the call of Jesus Christ, or you get caught up following some other man, you might not end up at the place you think you ought to. You can be deceived. You can be led astray. If you're following something, that means somebody's leading, right? We need to make sure that the leader is who we think it is, the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if you think you're following the Lord Jesus and you're really following a man, you can end up in some real trouble. Turn over, well, actually back up a couple of pages. 1 Peter 3, 17. 17 and 18. No, I have that wrong. I'm sorry. That should be 2 Peter. Second 2 Peter 3:17 and 18. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing you know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. See, Peter was talking to people just like you that knew the truth. He was talking to people that were just being reminded of the truth. And he said, ye therefore, beloved, seeing that you know these things before. I'm not telling you anything new. Amen? I'm just reminding you of some of the truth in the Bible about not getting caught up following men. Not getting intertwined in arguments of men, but following the Lord Jesus Christ and following the truth. I'm not telling you any new thing. I don't think I've told you anything new since I've been here. Amen? I've just been reminding you of the truth that you've already heard. And I need to be reminded from time to time of the truth that I've already heard and I've already understood. He said, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked. Boy, there's a lot of wickedness in our world today. There's a lot of wickedness even within churches today and within Christian realms and within Christian circles. A lot of wickedness. A lot of people being led away from the truth. A lot of things being allowed inside the church that were not allowed just, you know, even 20, 30 years ago, much less 150, 200 years ago. There are things going on in the church right now that in the early days, just think of Ananias and Sapphira. What happened to them? All they did is held back part of the money. And they were struck dead for it. And the great fear fell upon all the people. Look at the things that we have going on in churches today. And I say, oh Lord, spare us. Oh Lord, be merciful to us. Amen. Beware lest you also are led away with the error. The devil would love to get error started. He would love to get falsehood started. He would love to get false teaching started right here in Coulter's Chapel, because then he can lead many, many, many away. Amen. If he can get it started, if he can get it rooted down deep enough, before you know it, you folks won't even have a vote left in this place. That should be a sobering thought. A few years ago, I noticed in our bylaws that the bylaws were changed. And we opened it, or you opened it up, not we, I can't include myself with this one. But we, I have to say we, because you're part of me now. This church is part of me. This is in my heart now. It is we. We opened it up where anyone can vote. Before, the bylaws said that if you vote in the Church of God congregation, you can't hold membership in any other denomination. I'm sorry, folks. Warning sign. You're opening yourself up. We're opening ourselves up. Do you realize it wouldn't take too long for the pews to get full of people who oppose the Church of God? And you would no longer have any say in this place. I know I'm speaking to just a few of you, so I'm sharing my heart, and it's being recorded for the rest of them so they can hear it too. But I'm telling you right now, that's a warning sign. That is something we need to be very careful about, because we are few in numbers. It wouldn't take long for a big church to move in here, start sending some of their people over, occupying the pews, and before long, the message of revelations, the message of holiness, the message of righteousness, out the window, and you'll have nothing to say about it. I don't know where that came from. I don't know why that came up, but there it is. I put it out there. Be careful who you follow. I say that because the messages that I'll be bringing over the next few weeks really expand on the Church of God. So far, we've just dabbled in the edges. So far, we've just been along the edges of the water, the letters to the seven churches. And now we're looking at chapter 5 of Revelations and the scene of heaven there with the Lamb of God opening up, getting ready, preparing himself to open the seals. Amen. But when we open the seals and we start to unpack that and we start to reveal about the Church of God and what it means, amen, there's a great possibility of dissent. There's a great possibility that people that don't understand or don't want to hear it or don't accept it. I say these things that you be careful of who you follow. Be careful of the voices that you allow to penetrate your head and the things that you allow to penetrate your mind. Do not follow me, but follow the Lord Jesus Christ and His truth. And don't be ashamed to stand for it in all its glory. Amen. And He will be with you all the way. And He will protect you all the way. Amen. He's faithful and He's good to us. And He's been faithful to this congregation. Because you're still here and you're still alive. You're still going. And this morning we had probably 85 or 90, so we're doing all right. Now, if they'll just hear the Word of God and accept it as the truth that it is. Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for Your Word. We thank You that You have given us one example, Father, to follow, and that is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And oh, what a Savior that He is, Father. We thank You, Lord, for redemption. We thank You for salvation. We thank You, Lord, that our sins have been washed away, that we've been given robes of righteousness. And Father, we pray that You would help us in the coming weeks and months to live righteously and holy before You, proclaiming Your truth and proclaiming Jesus Christ in all His glory and majesty. And Father, we just pray that You would give grace to the ears of the hearers. For each and every one who comes in our midst on Sunday mornings, we pray, Father, that they would hear the Word of God, that they would hear the message of the church, and that they would comprehend it and understand it. And Lord, that it would become alive and real to them. And Father, that their lives would be transformed by the truth that goes forth from here. Father, help us never to follow any man. Help us, Lord, to heed only Your Word, only Your truth. Help us, Lord, to just shut out the things that would be contrary to You and to Your teachings. And we'll give You all the glory and the honor and the praise. In Jesus' name. Amen.